So, Appa, I guess you can share your screen and take the floor.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Aranyam. Yeah, I also would like to thank the organizers, especially Atiel and Dominic and Steve for the event. I think the Steel Journey, a global journey, is a new journey for Hari Balesha. I mean, it's another journey just started for him. And yeah, so this is the work that we have taken recently at Tata Steel to solve one of the perennial issues and also to take other challenges that has come up. So this is my team, and today I'm talking on behalf of my team. So without their help, this work couldn't have been possible, especially during the turbulent times of COVID. So I'll briefly explain the high carbon steel strip steels, what are their applications, and also briefly introduce the typical process, and also what are the problems and what are the challenges we have taken up during the last, I mean, mainly in the last 10, 15 months. And we have got a solution, and then I'll briefly close it with the way forward and what are the challenges and what are the things we have to look for ahead. So these are the typical hot rolled high carbon steels in the strip form. In the, I think, rod and the wire form, it's well known and researched and documented. But however, when it comes to the strip, there are other challenges that have come up, and also there's still some work is going on, especially the steels that is with high amount of carbon, something like 0.65 and 0.7, 0.8 weight percent, and more than that. I have shown here only up to 0.8 or 0.9% of carbon, but there are other steels with some alloying elements, which are even more challenging. So today, our focus is mainly on the heat-treated steels that are being used for various applications. So these are the few applications at the strips we provide, mainly like gangs for cutting marbles and granite, and also cutting the steels, saws for automotive components as well. And various other, there are other applications as well, like, I mean, Thiess India is one of the oldest company as Tata Steel India, and they provide, I mean, develop these components, various components shown here, from the steel strips of high carbon steel that we provide. And as it's shown here, there are endless applications, starting from the automotive chains and springs, washers, and precision water joints, I mean, pipe joints, and other things, other than what I have shown already, like paper clips. So these are all, I mean, if you see, notice clearly, there are of various thickness, and also they're machined to precision. So there are many challenges that have come up. So I'll show what is the process for developing those steel. What we provide is a hot rolled material in coil form, and that goes for the steel breaking and slitting, and then followed by removing of the scales by acid pickling. That's a normal process in any hot rolled strip processing. What is important here is the most important point is the annealing, and followed by cold drying to reduce the thickness and also have a surface finish, and followed by the cold processing and also machining and the cold forming. And then finally, hardening and tempering. That's an important part here. So the input material is in most of the cases is ferrite and perlite, or fully perlite or perlite plus cementite, and as in case of high pressure steels. So, but the final one is the hardened and tempered martensite. So these components go for high-end application where high wear resistance and also toughness is required. So the intermediate, I mean, process is only to make the process, I mean, to increase the machinability. So after machining, again, all the components go for a hardening treatment, and hence this process itself is an intermediate process. So the typical intermediate cycles usually carried at customer end varies depending upon the carbon content. It can be, in case of medium carbon steels, it is about 50% spheroidized and 50% laminar perlite. If it is more than 0.6%, then it has to be 100% spheroidized for good machinability and also cold forming component. So that is one of the, I mean, longer time consuming process in entire processing of these components, what I've shown in the application part. So the challenges and the problems that we face from the customers, and also how to increase the process further. But one of the problems, perennial problems, is the cracking during the slitting and also slow annealing, because the annealing process will take 20 to 40 hours. It's not just a one annealing cycle, it's a repeated, depending upon the final and initial thickness and how it is a final thickness required and final for further processing and all. So it's a quite a cumbersome and also time consuming process. So the challenge is always how to how to accelerate the annealing process, and hence the total time for the component development will be much lower. This is the typical steel we provide. We took that steel with 0.8% carbon along with the minor additions of manganese, silicon, and chromium. Manganese is about 0.6%, whereas silicon and chromium are 0.28% in both. So these are the typical properties of mechanical properties of the steel strip we supply to the customer, with about 1100 MPa tensile, followed with the 10% elongation. The problem is the slip on the strip, the coils we provide is cut along the length into three parts. So as you can see here, one of the coil was broke, one of the slip was broken here, and also you can see cracks over here. And here also we can see. So this makes the process discontinuous, and also getting back into the track is time consuming. That's where the quite a lot of time is lost, not only the material but also time is one. And this is another problem. Sometimes the pieces can fly off. These are of about 20 centimeters by 50 centimeters, and they are like knives. And they can be fatal and also intolerable in the plant conditions, because people move around in the plant and there's a safety issue as well. So we were looking at what are the various reasons for this one. And what we found is that from the literature that the smaller arsenide grain size increases both strength and ductility. Perlite colonies from a fine prior arsenide grain size also will have a more considerably more orientations, and hence therefore present more resistance to the crack propagation. Thus, the size of these orientations will actually increase the resistance to the crack. And also another work showed that prior arsenide grain size is the one that controls the final ductility of the material, not the perlite spacing or perlite cemented thickness. That's generally not the case. And also, it was shown that the prior arsenide grain size in fully perlite structure mainly controlled by the shear also. This is controlled by the prior arsenide grain size. So we have seen the mark structure mainly taking along the slitting direction as well as the crack direction. So this is the sample we have taken, and this is the mark structure. It's a fully paralytic, there's no problem as such, but it is nice. And with the interlaminar spacing, we measured it, it's about 150 nanometers. I'll show you some more pictures of this one. So this is the slitting or the shear direction, and what you see here are the cracks from originated from the slitting direction. Some of the cracks can be much deeper, and we also seen some subsurface cracks a bit far away from the shear or slitting direction. When we looked at there is not much. The cracks are going along. Across the cementite, there is no specific orientation, a specific reason or location of the cracks as such, but the cracks are much deeper and also going different side. So the formation of the cracks is not the problem, but their propagation, because during the slitting anyway, the microcracks would form, but during the further processing, there is a change of the load from the compression to tension or tension to compression, those cracks are propagating, that's causing the breaking of the coils. That's one of the major problems. And this is a fracture surface of the crack region that I shown before. So as you can see, it's a more like a brittle fracture. But when we look further down, this is more the dimensions are more correlated with the colony size or block size of perlite. When you look further down at a higher magnification, it shows a more ductile nature. So it is, at micro level, it is actually ductile, but with a higher level, it is showing some brittle fracture. Excuse me, I have to shift to another one. Annealing is one of the things that I'll stop that problem over there, and then I'll come to this one. So how to reduce the annealing time? There was quite a lot of work, but the problem is that how to implement in the existing steel plants and also within the available machinery. There are many things heating and heating above and below, intercritical annealing transformation temperature that can accelerate the spiralization. However, these things are not possible in the integrated steel plant and within the existing plant conditions that produces some millions of tons of steel. So, but there is one work that shows that deformation, giving a very high amount of deformation at around 700 degrees centigrade, followed by very slow cooling, can actually increase the spiralization. But this is with the case of high amount of carbon and also relatively low temperature. Very slow cooling. The strain it given is not very high. The reduction for this sample, they have given about 60% reduction and cooled at 0.2 degrees centigrade per second to 550 degrees centigrade after deforming at 700 degrees centigrade with, 1 per second strain rate. So we got some clue that what we can do within the existing plant conditions. So that's what we have taken one idea, mainly designing of rolling schedule so that we can uptime the smaller grains. And also train of net that can help in the early formation of carbides and also increase nucleation rate so that the final perlite colony or nodule size will be much smaller. And also the smaller grain size means that there are many opportunities for the spiralization during the annealing time, and also grain won't act as a diffusion channels so that the spiralization can be rapid. Further, high dissolution density in the material also helps in the pipe diffusion for the acceleration of the spiralization after coiling. So by assuming these things, we have designed rolling in such a way that we have a certain amount of deformation in the steel that can actually help us to get a more refined moisturizer and also some refinement in the cementite and the perlite moisturizer itself. So as we know, the recrystallization is mainly controlled by the four or five important parameters: temperature, interpass time, micro elongation, and strain and strain rate. So we have least control with the interpass time and micro elongation. So what we have in our hand is mainly strain and strain rate. Of course, temperature, but that's also limited because when we rule that mill at low temperature, there are many other issues that can come up, mainly the capability of the mill and all other issues like cobbling that can actually delay the entire schedule. So we played around the main strain and strain rate by increasing the strain in the last few stands, in the last couple of stands, and also increasing the strain rate by increasing the initial speed of the mill. Taken because when we give a high amount of reduction below no recrystallization temperature, that strain will remain, and that will help, especially just before the transformation, that will help for the formation of fine grains and also acceleration of the nucleation and growth. So this is what we have done in the conventional method. This is the mill parameters taken for the failed samples that we have supplied regularly. And this is what we have done here, mainly starting thickness from 29 to 4.5 mm, and then increasing the thickness of the transfer bar from 32 mm to 4.5 mm, and also with a relatively higher speed. And then what we found is that we can back calculate the mill flow stress, and we can see here is that there is a accumulated strain in the fifth and sixth pass. That is the strain we are talking about. And also the strain, mean flow stress is about 400 megapascals compared to 335 megapascals in case of conventional method. So this is, about 70 MPa stress is, stored in the material. So that is going to help us. This is the one for the failed sample that we have already seen. But whereas after modifying, you can see the moisture is dramatically changed, and also there is a it's no more perlite, but more like a discontinued or non-laminar perlite with sporadized perlite. Most important thing is here the hardness is reduced by about 30 to 40 recurse hardness. This is the one that's play a key role to address various issues at the customer end. The same pack, same samples, but at a higher magnification. The color code shows the a size distribution basically. And the elongation after the modifying the reduction schedule is increased by from 10% to about 16%. That means about 50 to 60% of improvement in the total elongation. And also strength is reduced as expected from the hardness values. And also bias is reduced, but more importantly, it's an elongation that's important to process the steel at the customer end. And then we have done some laboratory experiments to see if the steel can be spreadized much faster than the conventionally produced perlite one. So we treated the samples to different temperatures, 5.5 hours, 11, and 16.5 122 hours. Yeah, and as you can see here, the moisture of the conventional one at the top row, with the 5.5 hours, 11, 16.5, followed by 22 hours. Whereas the bottom one is for the new strategy. Here clearly we can see that it's the starting one itself is actually partially spreadized or non-laminar structure, so it is rapidly spreadizing. And when you compare to the 22 hours sample, it is as good as 11 hours in case of with modified structure. So then we have taken the hardness values. Let me just. Usually the expected hardness values for cold rolling is about 190 to 195 range. In the conventional one is heat treated, spreadized until the values are achieved around 195. So with present work, the same hardness values can be obtained within 14 hours. The 22, required hardness can be obtained within the, less than 14 hours. So there's a huge time, about 20 to 30% time saving for the spreadization. And the samples were supplied to the customers, and then what they did was that because the hardness is low and also it has got a good ductility, the steels are always annealed first before cold rolling. But because of the low hardness and also good ductility, they could give about 7% reduction. So that means that annealing furnace is further accelerated. So that time can be much lower than 14 hours or 12 hours, whatever we calculated. So it seems like the further reduction of hardness and also refined moisture is helping to reduce the total spreadation time at the plant scale is about 50%, at least 40 to 50%. And also the fracture surface of the tensile sample show more of a ductile fracture. So, and then we have seen the tensile fracture of perlite steel. What is the reason where the cracks are initiating when it's failing? One of the things we have found is that the cracks and crack growth is restricted to mainly to near the fracture surface itself. Wherever the subsurface, cracks away from the fracture region also, are within the ferrite, and whereas quite a high amount of ductility is shown by the cementite. So it is basically the cracks are originated in the ferrite that is actually fracturing. the cementite. So the colony size and dense, I think, controlling the overall properties of the steel. Whereas in case of modified one, the cracks are everywhere. And also we found that the cracks are much far away from the fracture surface. So that means that the energy is spent quite away from the fracture surface as well to neglect the cracks around these cemented particles. And then a lot of energy is spent before actually the sample was failed. So these are the controlling parameters probably for increased ductility in case of this modified one compared to the conventional perlite one. Yeah. So initial moisture is carried forward during the cold rolling, and hence further reduction should be possible because the initial one is partially spreadized or non-numbered. So that will actually will continue to be there in the later cold rolling and hot rolling. Annealing. So it will be much lower and lower in the further cycling. So another thing is that in the continuous sealing is found in the modified steel as well. So one of the reasons why this perlite steel takes quite long time for spreadization is the coherent interface, a semi-coherent or coherent interfaces of the ferrite and cementite. So that's the reason they have a continuous sealing in case of perlite. But the same thing is found here as well. That means that there is still a considerable amount of particles are not fully incoherent. Surfaces, but still there are some current faces at part of the steel or part of the cemented particles over there. And what is more important is that to know the orientation of the cemented formed in the modified one and how it is different from the perlite steel is something that need to be looked. And also role of prior austenite grain size, both in the spreadization and also the rate of spreadization is something need to be looked because that's the one I think playing a key role. Though this grain, prior austenite grain size is destroyed during the transformation, but the hysteresis remains. That's, I think, helping in case of modified steel. And also need to look at what is the role of texture, if there is anything that's helping for the rapid spreadation. And that's all I have for today. And I thank you, Hari.
So in the meantime, thank you, Appa. What do you mean by the role of texture? Do you mean texture created in the ferrite or cementite or what?
The texture created in the ferrite, that's what I was wondering. Because the final ferrite, the final perlite that has formed from the deformed austenite is quite refined and also maybe having some texture that we have to look at it.
Okay. Have you got any indications that the texture has an effect?
No. I'm wondering if there is any. No. I have no clue at it.
Okay.
Okay. So Professor Singh has a question.
Yeah, Appa, very nice and nice work. I have a simple question. If would the yielding change to discontinuous if cementite particles coarsen and the coherency is lost?
Yeah. If they coarsen, then the coherency will lost and hence the discontinuous yielding. But in our case, still we find continuous yielding. That is because the size itself is small compared to what we generally talk about. Because the particle size are small and some edges of the particles are still coherent. Mm-hmm. The reason it is still continuous, yeah. I think even if the particles are small, if the edges are incoherent, then it can rapidly spreadize much faster than what we have seen here.
Yes.
So I think the idea is to mainly refine the initial grain size and also incoherent particles so that even if it perlite with that, I think it will be spreadize rapidly.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Singh. Thank you, Appa. I have one question just out of curiosity. Like, do you see or expect any kind of anisotropy between the rolling direction and the transverse direction for this kind of strain?
Yeah, usually the strain
Do that have any effect on the kind of crackings that you see?
There is some anisotropy, but not sure what is its role, because anyway, the strips has to be slit along the length of the coil. I'm not sure about it. But those variation is inevitable in the strip cases. Yeah. So that's always there.
Another, yeah, just interesting observation. So like typically this kind of control thermomechanical processing at say like temperatures lower than TNR is used to be done to like increase the strength of the final product and increase the toughness. But in this case, it's kind of reverse. Like when we are doing like rolling at the lower TNR temperature, in the final product, the strength is decreased because of these spheroidized things.
So in case of perlite, I think the strength is mainly controlled by the interlaminar spacing.
Yeah.
So even if the arsenate grains is very small, if the perlite is more coarse, then the strength will not be very high. Further, what we are getting here is not the perlite. That's an important thing. It's a discontinuous network of carbides.
But here the point is to actually reduce the strength so that your customer can then subsequently process the steel into whatever they want to make, including by heat treatment, right?
Yes, that's true. Yeah.
Whereas normal thermomechanically processed steels, you're going to use them as delivered.
As delivered, yes. Yeah. For the customer, they all need is a composition. It doesn't matter what is the initial moisture. At the end, it's a tempered martensite.